Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
You liked that one, didn't you?
Oh, yeah.
Sean and I were talking about his ability to whim to help out the dog Dutch with his hot dog creation. And, of course, he didn't get help from a certain sector. He wanted to text him. And I said, just tell him. I said, winning this is like bowling a 300 instead of a 298.
Twelve bagger. I think 251 is the closest I've ever came to rolling a 300.
Well, he bowled 298, right?
It was either 97, 98. You're not off. If it's not 98, you're not off by much.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I don't even think I bowled 298 for a series. One game. And then, you know, whenever I go, I have fun. All right. Indians last night. People who say that aren't good.
Yeah, that's barely averaging 95 a game. That's almost as bad as hitting 189 a season, like Joey Gallo.
Yeah. Except I'm out there and I'm paying to go out and bowl. Right. Joey Gallo's getting millions of dollars at 189.
Yeah.
All right. So last night, the Indians have a 4-0 lead over the Reds in the ninth inning. So Terry Francona brings in his closer, Cody Allen. And it's not Cody Allen's best night. He gives up a 2-run single, a 2-run double, pair of walks. He loads the bases. So the lead's now 4-3. And Joey Votto hits left-handed, is coming up to the plate. So Terry Francona goes to the mound, and he wants to bring in the left-hander, Oliver Perez. The problem is Oliver Perez is not warming up in the bullpen. That's an issue. No Oliver Perez. Can't go to him. And he makes the move, and when you make the move, you got to make the move. Okay? So they bring in right-hander Dan Otero. So why did the Indians have Otero in the game and not Perez? Francona said afterward, pitching coach Carl Willis to get OP warming up. But Willis mistakenly thought he meant OT, meaning Otero. And now the call on the Reds radio network.
Here's a 3-2 again, and a high drive hammered back into right center field. That ball's over his head, and one run is score, and two runs are going to score. And here comes a third runner to the plate, a 3-run, 2-out double by Joey Votto here in the ninth inning, and the Reds have jumped out in front by a score of 6-4.
I think the Indians fans, I thought, took it well. You could hear them in the background. I thought they handled it really well. Reds scored 7 runs and won the game 7-4. You know, they have cameras down in the bullpen. And they have cameras. The manager can look at the camera and see which guy's warming up. That'll be the last time they decide to do things in code.
No, I'll give Tito Francona a lot of credit. He manned up not long after that game, too.
Hey, when you've won 2 World Series, like he has, you've got cachet, all right? You've got a bank account where you can sit there and you can man up about it. And now, this goes back, obviously, to things like this happen, that's a mistake, as opposed to analytics say that Aaron Nola has to be taken out in the sixth inning. No! He's a number one. He's an ace. But as I said about Gabe Kapler, what did I say? Let's see what he's doing on June 30th. Okay? All right, Dick in Milton is ready to buy hot dogs.
Steve, I wanted to tell you something. I spent a little time over at the Haven, the home, and I actually got to play. I actually walked double Dutch in Dutch.
Oh, very cool.
That's really cool, Dick.
Well, he's kind of a neat dog. He really is. He's had some health issues, obviously, like people do. So hopefully they get him squared away and tell Sean good luck with that hot dog thing. That's kind of a neat story, though.
Yeah.
Isn't that great what he did? He got involved, and how creative.
Yeah, really, yeah. It's actually, it's almost like one of those Pittsburgh sandwiches where they put everything on it they can find, you know, how that, they're kind of famous for that stuff out there.
Oh, that's what I said. I said earlier, Dick, I said they put slaw and fries on everything. I mean, I got an ice cream sundae with hot fudge and slaws and fry.
Yeah.
Like, what are we doing here?
Hopefully, raise some real money for the dog. He's really a kind of a neat little dog.
A small world, Dick. You actually met Dutch. That's really, really cool.
I've actually walked him.
That's terrific. And
the next thing I wanted to tell you, while you guys were having that first show, I was actually watching the Natal and the Potro tennis match. It went almost 5 hours. It was probably, and he was on the court. It was maybe possibly one of the three or four or five best tennis matches I've ever seen in my life. It was unbelievable.
And Anderson and Federer before that, I watched that one before the show, Dick.
Right.
That was dynamic. That one went 14-12 in the fifth set.
I saw the end of that one, and then the town match was just unbelievable. I can't believe those guys can play for 4 or 5 hours and play at that level that consistently, and then somebody can't play 3 or 4 or 5 innings of baseball. I won't go there. But
and Federer and Nadal are not 22-year-olds any longer.
No.
They are in phenomenal shape.
Yeah, it makes you feel kind of bad that they are not that good of shape, but you weren't in that good of shape, I guess. So anyhow, but it was an incredible match. I literally was going to turn away from it. I couldn't. It was actually, the World Cup was on at the same time, but the tennis match was just unbelievable. At the level that they played in, it was incredible.
And Nadal won, right?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
He broke him, and then he actually came back and won. But it was you know, he got close to getting broken against him at the, you know, and he came back. It's just, it's at that level, it's unbelievable.
I mean,
it was like four hours and 50 minutes, I think it was. That's a long time to play at that level.
I mean, it's phenomenal. I mean, all the running that they do. And, you know, the shots they pull off. I mean, Nadal the other day tracked one down and flipped it back between his legs. I'm like, if I do that, I'm face down to the grass.
Well, they were face down to the grass. They both fell a couple times and several times. Nadal fell like twice in a minute. I don't know what happened, and he just kind of lost his balance a couple times. And same with the Potro. He actually fell on his bad wrist a couple times. I'm thinking, is he going to play? But he got up and played. And I think he said that he had 3 or 4 wrist surgeries. Yeah. So he has to be a little careful when he falls down, especially on his wrist.
no question. But they anyway, are phenomenal athletes.
Yeah, tell Sean good luck with that double Dutchie, because that's what they call him, or some of the guys call him double Dutch.
Double Dutch. Hey, it's really cool you went over there and walked them, though, Dick. That says a lot about you.
I'll tell you what, if you get on their website, his photo's on there. I'm sure, you know, you could actually maybe save it to your Facebook page. It's kind of neat.
That's great.
Haven to home. They have about 4 pages of dogs on there, and Dutch is on there.
I mean, Sean, can you throw it on our Facebook page?
Yeah, we'll look for it. Mm-hmm.
There you go.
Yeah,
it'll mean a little bit more. The hot dog will mean a little more with his photo there.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks a lot, guys.
No, thank you, Dick. Thank you. That was wonderful.
Yeah, when they were opening up to the voting for the hot dog contest, they had a picture of Dutch in a hot dog costume. It's like he was ready to go out trick-or-treating for Halloween. Like Dutch the hot dog in an actual hot dog costume.
Well, I understand there was somebody in the station once a Dutch loves digital media. I mean, you just can't. Hey, you just can't steal his likeness. Yeah. Dutch's likeness. You can't do it. I mean, the digital media guys, they're all about cash.
Yeah.
Oh, boy. Okay. So that's great. The World Cup. Croatia and England are 1-1.
Extra time.
Extra time.
Love it.
Anderson beat Federer in five sets, as we just talked about. De Potro was beaten by Nadal in five sets. Wow. So that's big. That's big.
Yeah, and Serena has made it to the semifinals on the women's side.
Okay. I saw a great stat on Serena Williams the other day. Great stat. She lost the opening set in the quarterfinals the other day and came back and won. Now, it sounds like that's a story that we've heard before. In the open era, in majors, the four majors, Serena Williams is over 500 in matches she has fallen down and lost the opening set. When she's lost the opening set, she is over 500. The only other player in the Open era that's 500 or better is Chris Evert at 500 when losing the opening set in a major. I think Serena's like 58, 59%. It's phenomenal. Phenomenal. Talk about another incredible athlete. Whew. That's... Whew. We don't talk about tennis often, but all right. So Croatia and England extra time. You have an entire nation on absolute edge right now. I can't imagine there is one TV set in England right now that's not on.
Yeah, there's like multiple watch parties going on in the UK, and I saw a photo of a huge party in Hyde Park, and they showed the shot of everybody in the park going absolutely bonkers when England scored first on that set piece about 6 minutes in. They're throwing beer all over the place. It was incredible. You'd have thought they'd won the whole thing.
Well, that's the emotion I want to see for the sport in this country. Look, when they played in Brazil, the U.S. won its opening match in Brazil 4 years ago, right? I think so. And I watched every second of it. Then they played Portugal, and I thought they had it. And then, you know, Portugal scored late, and it's like, okay, great. But that's what I'm hoping for in this country, that, you know, when the World Cup comes here, or the next World Cup, which is scheduled for Qatar, as I said, scheduled, that, you know, they can win a couple of matches and get this country engaged. Because, I mean, look, I was on the edge of my seat 4 years ago every time they played. I didn't really care about the other matches. I cared about when the U.S. played. I ain't so label me a casual fan, but I watched. I'm hoping that happens in this country with it. Pirates won today. They beat Washington 2-0. Tampa Bay now Detroit 4-2. Giants in the bottom of the second lead the Cubs 4-0 in San Francisco. Bottom of the eighth, the Twins lead the Royals 8-4 at Target. All right. And England and Croatia 1-1 extra time. I've got here the 107th minutes, probably later than that now, right?
That's what I got, too. They just started the second portion of extra time.
Okay, all right.
Yep.
Okay. Remarkable. But give Kevin Anderson credit for winning the way he did today. We are also counting down to Penn State football, because by the end of the month, it's going to be training camp time. And here it is, the 11th of the month. And I don't think this particular season can get here fast enough for a lot of people. You know, I'm the same way. You know, we were talking about me coming in the 22nd. We're going to be at what sounds like Front Street Station again, right?
Yep, we're back there. You bet.
and the door is open. We might actually do the show there too, right?
That is in the works.
Yeah. So we're looking forward to that. But that's where we are. We're closing in on the start of this camp, and there's a lot of anticipation for what this team can do, and it has the schedule that if they negotiate it, they're in. Now, negotiating it is a different story. It's going to take a lot to negotiate this schedule. But they've been handed a schedule because of their conference schedule where if you can beat Ohio State, Michigan State, Michigan, and Wisconsin and take care of your business in the other eight games where you're considered the favorite, it's not a 50-50 game. I mean, you are in. They've got the schedule to do it. Also, this is what I like about the placement of the Wisconsin game. Now, you got at Michigan on the 3rd of November. You've got Wisconsin here. This is what was missing in last year's schedule. Remember, last year, of course, they lost to Ohio State by one. And then, of course, they had that bizarre game with the 3-hour and 24-minute weather delay and the whole deal. Right. I actually had somebody come up to me, and they're critical about how Penn State wasn't prepared for it. I'm like, oh, you're kidding me. In the entire 130-something year history of Penn State football, this has never happened before, ever, ever. I can guarantee you today they are absolutely prepared if it ever happens again. Like, some people come up with just bizarro things to say. And what they didn't have after the Michigan State game was this. They did not have another signature game on the schedule that could get them back into the good graces. You know, that because they closed out last year with Rutgers. Maryland was the last game. What was the other game? It was three straight games against... trying to think what the last three games were last year. Rutgers and Maryland were two of them. Maryland was the last game of the season. And all of them were games that you're supposed to win. Yeah, you're supposed to win all those games. And that was Nebraska. That's right, it was Nebraska. Now, Nebraska normally would have been in that category of, hey, that can get you back on track. But Nebraska had a lousy year last year. That's why Scott Frost is now the head coach. And Penn State did not have another game where you can throw a left hook, knock a big one out, and have everybody go, ooh, okay, wait a minute. See, this year's schedule has that. You know, you've got Ohio State at the end of September. You get a bye week. Then you get Michigan State. You're not playing them in back-to-back weeks. You get a bye week. Huge. After Ohio State, that's huge. Last year, I felt the Ohio State-Penn State game cost both teams the next week dearly. Ohio State played lousy against Iowa. Got blown out. And Penn State, of course, even though it was a close game, lost in the last play of the game, I think that, you know, I think both teams allowed the depth of the game in Columbus to beat them the next week. Happens. Well, now Penn State has Ohio State here, bye week, then Michigan State, then a couple of weeks where they play, but they would be in the favored category, and then they've got Michigan, and then they got Wisconsin. So if there's any fault that happens somewhere in that schedule, they've got a chance to make up for it late because of the caliber of competition they're playing. Now, you could go out and schedule, for example, Mercer or the Citadel. Oh, wait, that's what Clemson and Alabama do. We'll come back with more in a moment on News Radio 1070 WKOK. All right, Croatia has scored. They lead 2-1. England needs to find something to get this to penalty kicks. an entire nation in depression. Even Theresa May knows what the score is right now. And it's not good. How are you going to vote at the NATO summit? We're down 2-1. Don't care.
Oh, okay.
One more half hour to go. Great to have you with us today. On News Radio 1070 WKOK, brought to you by Sunbury Motors.
City blocks of new Ford trucks. Over 40,000 trucks sold. SMC is where you want to be.
Sunbury Motors Ford has over 110 new Ford trucks. And during July, they'll include a complimentary accessory package. With the purchase of any new F-150 through July 31st, receive a tonneau cover, molded flash guards, and window deflectors
at no additional charge. SMC is where you want to be.
Because they have the largest selection of new Ford trucks
in all of central Pennsylvania.
And that means the biggest savings.
Take up to $13,500 off on new F-150s, and SMC has them starting as low as $26,669. Save up to $7,000 on 2018 Ford Escapes,
and they're slashed as low as $19,380.
2018 Explorers, Edges, and Expeditions will also be clearly marked with discounts up to $8,000.
SMC is where you want to be in July
for this mega summer spectacular sale and the complimentary F-150 accessory package. Sunbury Motors in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury.
F-150 accessory package valued at $699. Excludes prior sales and order units.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
All right, what, 2 minutes extra time now? And Croatia leads England 2-1.
Yeah, they actually added 4 minutes of extra time. They're halfway through, and for at least the last 10 minutes... England's been playing with 10 men due to an injury, so they must have burned all their substitutions early.
Right. I'm sure. Okay. So England needs to come up with some late miracle here to get to penalty kicks. Which right now they would be thrilled with to get there. They'd be thrilled to get there. All right. The Phillies are they off tonight? I think they're off tonight, right?
Actually, they wrap up their series with the Mets tonight.
The Mets, oh.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, the Mets are horrible.
Yeah, and then they'll be playing right through Sunday. They have to head to Baltimore for a makeup game tomorrow.
Yeah, no, I knew that. They have a makeup game with Baltimore tomorrow, and as bad as the Mets are, the Orioles are worse. While coming off as a joke, it's not a joke, because that is one of the big issues in baseball. There are too many bad teams, And what's really, what drives it home and makes the situation worse is that we haven't had expansion in 20 years. We haven't had an expansion team in 20 years in baseball. So this is not a case of, hey, the Seattle Pilots, the Kansas City Royals, the Montreal Expos, and the San Diego Padres are all in. Their expansion teams are all bad, and we're winning. Every team in baseball is an established team. That's why the Vegas Golden Knights thing is so bad. It's good for the NHL, but an expansion team made the final. They beat out all these established teams. And, I mean, baseball has nothing but established teams. And all these established teams, Royals, world champions 3 years ago, White Sox, world champions 13 years ago, and the Orioles, perennially really, really good, all of them are in the tank for 108 losses or better this year. And the Mets aren't very good. I mean, you keep going through the list of teams that just aren't good. And you don't feel like what Atlanta's done has been remarkable. The Phillies and the Braves are the two up-and-comers. And the tough part is they're both in the same division. And Seattle would be an up-and-comer in the West. And to Oakland's credit, Oakland's playing better. But there are too many, I mean, legitimate, absolute bottom feeders that are playing right now. I mean, I don't want to pick on one guy in particular, but I go back to Joey Gallo. Texas is playing him every single day, and he's got 21 home runs. Great, but he's hitting 189. But that's the state of certain teams right now. You've got so many, I mean, so the really good teams are really good. Houston, Seattle, Boston, the Yankees, right? And Cleveland's not bad. Milwaukee, good. Not great, but good. Dodgers, good. Not great. Arizona, good. Not great. Atlanta, Philadelphia, both good. Not great. And then you've got a bunch of bottom teams that are just amazing. And the Cleveland Browns are bad. They're, what, 1-31 their last 32 games?
Croatia has defeated England 2-1. Game-winning goal, 108th minute. The first opening few minutes of the second portion of extra time. So you got Croatia versus France for the World Cup on Sunday. I believe it's 11 a.m. East Coast time on Sunday. But you're right about bottom feeders. I mean, Baltimore is now 40 games under 500. Kansas City is 39 games under 500, 26-65. I mean, you talked about Texas. We've been talking about JoJo here throughout the show. I mean, the Rangers are 40-53. They're in last place. I mean, no one really gave Miami a shot at all this year. The Marlins are 38-56. Yeah. So
these are the teams right now that are playing 467 or worse. Because, I mean, the Pirates are six games under. Okay. Well, let's be honest about it. Since starting 12-3, okay, the Pirates are 31-46. They are 15 games under 500 since they started 12-3. But San Diego, Cincinnati, Pittsburgh, Miami, the Mets, okay, all 467 or lower. Texas, the Royals, White Sox, Tigers, Twins, Blue Jays are at 467, and the Orioles.
I'll tell you what, though, the last week or so, when you hear Washington Nationals fans talk, you would think that team was in last place. I mean, they're now sitting at 46-46. They pretty much think their season's done.
Well, they just lost two out of three to the Pirates. They just lost two out of three to the Pirates. That doesn't help the cause. I mean, you're expected to go into Pittsburgh and win two out of three. You're supposed to win the series if you got the talent that Washington has. So the Phillies right now have a one-game lead on Atlanta. One game. And they're 12 games over. And they're 8-2 their last 10. They have a one-game lead. The Brewers have a game-and-a-half lead on the Cubs. And the Diamondbacks are a game-and-a-half better than the Dodgers. And I'll say this. The National League West, 4.5 games separate the top four teams. Arizona's a game and a half up on the Dodgers, 4 up on the Giants, 4.5 up on Colorado, and all four teams are over 500. Problem with Colorado is they've been giving up so many runs. Colorado's given up 454 runs already this year. That's a gigantic number. I mean, the Marlins have given up 480. Hey, now, in the American League, the Red Sox lead the Yankees by 3.5. The Indians are the only team in the Central over 500. They have an 8-game lead in the Twins. And in the West, Houston and Seattle are both playing 620 or better. Houston leads the Mariners by 4 games. I mean, let's give the A's credit. I mean, the A's are 7-3 their last 10. They're 10 games back. At least they're hanging in there. And 4 of the 5 teams in the West are 500 or better. You have 3 teams in the American League East 500 or better, 1 in the Central, 4 in the West. In the National League, you got 3 teams 500 or better in the East, 3 teams 500 or better in the Central, and 4 teams 500 or better in the West. So, and by the way, we see all the home runs. Right? A lot of home runs being hit, right? Believe it or not, scoring is down from the same time last year. How about that? Average runs per game is actually down, despite all the home runs. Croatia won today. Beat England 2-1 extra time. England is out there at the moment hoping that there's still penalty kicks, and they're trying to tell them it's time to go home. It's not good. So that is over with. And then Nadal won in five sets, but Federer lost to Kevin Anderson in five sets. So Croatia plays France at 11 a.m., which I believe is 6 p.m. Russia time, I believe. Unless it's in Moscow, then I think Moscow thinks 8 hours ahead. So that'd be 7 o'clock at Moscow time.
I believe that's where they're playing it, yes.
So very nice.
There's a good pitching matchup tonight, Phillies-Mets. Vince Velasquez coming back from the DL, and you got Jake DeGrom for the Mets tonight.
Well, DeGrom is a big-time talent. There's no getting around it. He is. I mean, despite the fact the Mets are scary bad, and they are scary bad. My goodness, they are bad. I mean, that's why when I talk about the money part, you have to be smart with how you spent your money. See, that's where I admire what the Phillies have done. I felt and have said the entire time, and I've not wavered from this, but I felt that the Phillies spent their money wisely on the right kind of free agent. A guy like Santana who gets on base a lot, who's pretty good around the first base bag, good pickup. Okay, Arrieta, older pitcher, can get out there, tutor the younger guys, good pickup. I mean, Nishak, who's finally back in action now, he's going to help them out of the bullpen. I mean, they make good pickups. I like what they did. Then there's the Mets, who are trying to sign this free agent, that free agent, and who does it work out for them? It doesn't work out for the Mets. The Mets won the World Series 3 years ago, and they're going to have the rotation of all rotations now. The single most positive story in the Mets organization is Tim Tebow made the AA All-Star game. He's 31. That's not good. The Mets are a mess. You got to give them credit. Having the Yankees in town does not help the Mets either. I think sometimes they make certain moves trying to counter the Yankees. And they feel like that half the time the Mets are panicking when they make moves. They get guys out too. Syndergaard's on the 10-day DL, Cespedes is on the 10-day DL, Jay Bruce is on the 10-day DL, Vargas is on the 10-day DL, and Asdrubal Cabrera is in the same category you and I happen to be. They list him as day to day. And it's not like the Phillies are blistering at the plate right now. The Phillies have a .236 batting average as a team, but the Mets are only .228. That's the other part, is when you look at the numbers, Sean, nobody's hitting.
That's just crazy, though. And they ripped off 11 wins in their first 12.
Yeah. Are you talking about the Mets?
Yes.
Oh, yeah,
yes.
The Mets are, it's bad. It's just bad. Okay, look at what teams are doing right now. Okay, this is what teams are doing. The Red Sox lead the majors in hitting right now. And the Red Sox as a team are hitting .271. Now that's it. That's pretty good. And their on base percentage is .338. Right? Then you get Houston is hitting .262, the Yankees .252. Indians .254, the Cubs are hitting .265, Atlanta .259, Cincinnati .258, pretty good for a last place team. Dodgers .243, Colorado .252. All right, let me get this in some semblance of order here, make it a little bit easier. Okay. You got you have right now 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 teams hitting 240 or less. It's almost a third. The Orioles are hitting 228. The Mets are hitting 228. Arizona's in first place. They're hitting 231. San Diego, 232. The Phillies are only 226. They're 236, I mean. Toronto, 236. Texas, 237. But they got Joey Gallo. Kansas City and Minnesota, 240 each. And the White Sox are 242. I mean, nobody's hitting. I mean, nobody's hitting. I mean, it's amazing. The Phillies are in first place hitting 236. I never would have thought that. I thought if the Phillies were in first place, they'd be hitting 260. Seriously. I thought they'd be hitting 260. Or at least 255 as a team. I mean, 236 is normally a prescription for disaster. That tells you how well they pitched, how well they played defensively, and they've been able to come up with key hits at key moments. That's what it tells you. I mean, that's what it tells you. I mean, the team slugging percentage is not bad at 394. I mean, you know, you want to be over 400, but that's not bad. Their on-base percentage is 321. Well, that's higher than all the teams until you get to the Dodgers, who are 20th in batting average. So, I mean, that's the analytic part, the 321 part. But the Red Sox are first. Red Sox have a 463 slugging percentage, 338 on base percentage, 271 batting average. I mean, those are normal numbers. They've hit 130 home runs this year. The Yankees have hit 151 home runs. 151. But again, there are more strikeouts than home runs. All right, we will come back, wrap up the broadcast extravaganza that is this show in a moment as we continue on News Radio 1070 WKOK. All right, you may not be aware that this happened today, but we'll make you aware of it. Over the years, the NFL, of course, has the regular draft. But in July, there is always something called the supplemental draft. And I'll give you an example. Bernie Kosar, for example, was a supplemental draft pick. Well, today they held the supplemental draft. And what happens is that when you draft somebody in a round and you put in on a piece of paper a bid for a player, what round you would take them in, and if two teams happen to bid on the same guy, and one team says second round, the other guy says third, whomever says second round gets it. Two players were selected in the supplemental draft today in the NFL. And what happens in the next draft? You lose that round because you already used it in the supplemental draft. So today the Giants used a third-round pick for defensive back Sam Beal out of Western Michigan. And Beal is a guy that, I mean, a lot of people really like. The Giants did not go after the secondary in the regular draft. So now they go after him because they're looking, okay, what's the best veteran option the Giants have in the secondary right now? That's William Gay, who's 33 now. So Beal is a guy that they used a third-round pick in the supplemental draft to get. They love his man-to-man ability. And pretty good ball skills. Long corner as well. They think Beal has a chance to maybe be a nickel for them. So what will happen is that in next spring's draft, by taking Sam Beal of Western Michigan now, the Giants will forfeit a third-round pick. The Washington Redskins made the other supplemental draft pick, and they also went secondary. And I think this was also a good move because they did it in round six. They got Adonis Alexander out of Virginia Tech. Now, you're talking about a secondary between Josh Norman and Orlando Scandrick. Those are the top two corners the Redskins have. You're talking about a guy in Alexander who has absolute at Virginia Tech flashes of brilliance and absolute flashes of disaster. He played at Virginia Tech like he was an absolute late first round pick, and he played other times at Virginia Tech like he was an absolutely undrafted guy. But you know what? He is a guy that has really good skills. He's got length, and at least they can ease him into what's going on. They can really treat 2018 with Adonis Alexander because he's a sixth round supplemental draft pick, which means the Redskins will forfeit their sixth round pick in next spring's draft. But as a sixth round pick, they can either put him on the regular squad as a deep backup and teach him, or they can put him on the developmental squad and teach him. He'll be on the roster either way. But they can use this year to let him learn. I mean, he's not going to surpass Skandrick. He's not going to surpass Josh Norman, obviously. And they also, you know, Fabian Moreau and Greg Stroman are already there. And Stroman's a guy I think is going to be a good player for them. So I think both teams, both the Giants and the Redskins, did a good job today getting what they needed. Giants needed a younger guy that can play corner in Sam Beal. They got him out of Western Michigan in the third round. And Adonis Alexander, who has those flashes of brilliance and those flashes of disaster. I mean, Alexander's the kind of guy, if you're facing a mediocre passing attack, is going to do really well. If you're facing a sophisticated, high-power passing attack, he's going to struggle. And the reason I went into detail on that is I know Roger's listening and he wanted to know about as much as we could about Adonis Alexander. I think, you know, in the sixth round, say Adonis Alexander were picked by the Redskins in the third round, I would be sitting here saying, I'm not so sure about that. But the fact they picked him in the sixth round of the supplemental draft today, to me, that makes it a worthy move. Because they can work with him this year, get him up to speed on some things, teach him, and all they're doing is forfeiting a sixth-round pick in next spring's draft. Hey, I think that's smart business right there. Back tomorrow, we're going to talk to a beat writer from the New Orleans Pelicans about Tony Carr, among other topics tomorrow. Croatia beat England 2-1.
You're listening to News Radio 1070 WKOK Sunbury. You can hear us anywhere in the world with the Sunbury Broadcasting Corporation app.